Sweep Spot is a member of the Mice Chat Podcast Network, micepod.com. Now, the magical kingdom in a mixed up world.
You're in the sweet spot, baby. You're in the sweet spot, girl. You're in the sweet spot, darling. It's a magical kingdom in a mixed up world. You're in the sweet spot, baby. You're in the sweet spot, girl. You're in the sweet spot, darling. It's a magical kingdom in a mixed up world.
Welcome to the Sweet Spot Podcast. My name is Lynn, your host, and Ken, my co-host. How's it going, Ken?
Yay, we're here.
It's going well. It's going well. I'm looking forward to our interview today.
Yeah, are you getting ready for Christmas? Do you have your decorations up yet?
Got some of them up, yes.
Yeah, we do too.
So, got the elf on the shelf is visiting.
Oh, nice. I figure we'll put them up around Thanksgiving, so they're up, you know, for at least a month. You're going to go through all the work of putting them up. You might as well have them up for a while, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, welcome again to the Sweep Spot. We're former Disneyland custodial cast members, and we talk about Disneyland history and stories of us working there, and we have interviews with many different people that have either worked for the Disney company or have written about it, just like our guest tonight.
We also cover some current events that are happening at the resort, so that's you can keep up to date on what's happening just by listening to our podcast.
And as a lot of you may know, we are also authors, and we wrote a book called Cleaning the Kingdom, and it can be bought at our website, preferably. That's where you can get an autographed copy. And you can get that at www.thesweepspot.com. Or you can get it at Amazon. Look for the seller, The Sweep Spot, under Amazon. Or you can go to Kindle or Nook and get the book also. And I believe at your nearest Barnes & Noble, if they don't have it, they can order it for you too. Think that will do it on, I have something, but probably not a lot of listeners live in the Utah area, but if you do, I'm going to be at the Barnes & Noble on December 21st from, I think it's from 6 to 8 o'clock, I believe. So I'll be there signing the books, and so come on down, say hi, and love to see you. If you're a listener of the show and you come in, I may have something special for you. So,
what would that be? Is that like a big wet kiss or what?
No.
Oh, okay.
I'll probably have a butt. So, yeah.
All right.
Well, let's just get right into the current events. Now we're going to have the current events. How's it going, Ken?
Oh, it's going fabulous, Lynn. Awesome. Speaking of fabulous, Shelley's Fabulous Things. The fabulous Disney babe has written over at micechat.com some fabulous things to think about getting this holiday season. And prominently featured is Cleaning the Kingdom by you and I.
Awesome.
So she was kind enough to promote that, and we thank her for that, and we will have a link to all the other things. You can see her list, and people should, of course, go to micechat.com anyway to keep up to date on what's happening at Disneyland, because they regularly do have a photo a photo heavy update showing what's happening at the park, and actually both parks, the whole resort. So go there and check it out. And you know, there's really not a lot going on right now. As we record, the candlelight ceremony is going on. It's happening this weekend. Our recording schedule has been kind of different because for the holidays, end of the year, so we're recording on a different night than usual. But the one thing I did want to bring up, in addition to telling you that we made that list, was at Mouse Planet, David Koenig, who is one of our favorite authors, he has written a piece called Sliver of Rivers of America, and it's kind of about losing the tranquility and some of the little things about Rivers of America, potentially with the Star Wars land construction. Now, I've repeatedly said that I think they should build Star Wars land as part of Tomorrowland, maybe even connecting Tomorrowland and the Hollywood section of California Adventure, a la the Harry Potter thing out in Florida that Universal has. Heck, they could even do a Star Wars themed hotel along Harbor Boulevard there. But anyway, he takes kind of an in-depth look at it, and I guess we're not going to know for certain until after it happens, because, you know, some of the original stuff kind of portrayed this as all happening in an area where, you know, we'd lose the ranch, but other than that, we weren't going to be losing anything. Well, now it seems to be that it's kind of, well, like I said, we'll see what it turns out to actually be, but there's lots of people saying that it's going to actually be further south, so it's going to take up the backside of the river, which is why the river is going to be closed and that it is going to be altered. And there actually be three ways to access it, one from Critter Country, one near the exit of Big Thunder Mountain where the abandoned train tunnel is, and the other way would be back by the Big Thunder Ranch, so that, you know, so the land would basically impose itself on what is the northern tip of the river right now, so the river would be shortened. But we'll see what the final thing is going to be. I mean, it's I agree with a lot of what Koenig wrote about, you know, if we lose this stuff, kind of the feel of these little things at the park that don't have to be part of a big, you know, intellectual property thing or a part of a big attraction or show, just these little corners, you know, like the Snow White Grotto. I mean, yes, it's using the Snow White intellectual property, but it's just, you know, just this little corner that's not trying to sell you anything. So we'll see. It's worth a look, and there's really not much else going on as far as the parks go. But of course, this is all stuff that's going to play out over the next couple of years with the development of Star Wars land, and it also remains to be seen if Seasons of the Force will go away in May or extend. I mean, Disney seems to have taken away references to it ending in May. So it might keep going until, who knows, maybe until Star Wars Land.
Yeah, like you said, there's really not a whole lot of new developments. There's, you know, they're in full swing right now for Christmas. One of my favorite times of year to work there.
But, it only lasts about 3 months now.
So. Oh, yeah. Only 3 months. Yeah. So, you know, fortunately, I don't think I'll be able to get down there for the Christmas decorations and everything, but there'll be other years. But, yeah, you're right. Just not a whole lot going on, but we're definitely every day I'm checking out new information, and we'll bring it to you as soon as we get any new developments.
Yeah. All right. Stay tuned, and we will be sure to bring you updates as they happen.
Great. Well, I'm looking forward to our interview tonight.
Me too. Let's get to it.
Have you ever seen a haunted house? You know the kind I mean. That old dark house that's usually at the end of a dimly lit street.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've just dropped our booster engines, and in a moment we'll make what we call a hyperspace jump. The new method of space travel, which enables us to cover enormous distances in seconds.
Gomer, let's show 'em how it's done.
Ain't he a sight for sore eyes?
Well, he sounds better than he looks, that's for sure.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Yup, soon the bells will start. And the thing that'll make them ring is a carol that you sang right within your heart. Howdy, folks, and welcome to this special Christmas celebration at the good old...
Okay, next up, we have another guest on our show, and I'm very excited to have him on our show. He's done voice acting for Disney and other companies, and he's also done some acting. And I'm very happy to have him, and his name is Pete Renaday. Welcome to our show, Pete.
Thank you very much, Lynn.
Yeah. So I wanted to first ask you, how did you get involved working for Disney?
For Disney? Well, I started off as a messenger like so many people do, just delivering the mail. And I only did that for about 7 months. Then I got into the art props department. And at the time, there was what was called the Disney Players on the lot. And they did one play a year for Walt's favorite charity, which was the John Tracy Clinic. And they saw me in a few plays that way and started using me here and there for a voice here or to read with all of the young people that were auditioning for movie roles. And they threw a few small parts my way from time to time.
Oh. And about when was this?
Oh, this was all through the 60s and early 70s. Well, actually, most of the 70s.
Were you there when Walt Disney was alive?
Oh, yeah. I was there 7 years. I had been there for 7 years
He died. Did you have any run-ins with him, talking to him or see him at the lot there?
Well, the only time I really talked to him or it was noticed, I think, by him was during the plays, and he'd come backstage after the shows and shake hands with everybody and, say, you guys did a nice job here. I remember a funny thing happened. Some lady, we had done the Glass Menagerie, which was not the kind of show we usually did. We always did light comedies, like we did The Happiest Millionaire on stage, which was not a musical, but they had bought the rights to it. And the director at the time, John Rust, was asked by Walt to put it on stage because he had never seen it. And John said, well, I don't know if we could cast that father the lead role. And Walt said, oh, I'll ask Brian Keith to do it. And sure enough, Brian Keith came over and did it for nothing, as far as I know, and just to help out for the John Tracy Clinic. I'm sure he kind of thought when they do the movie, I'll get the part. But it didn't work out that way, unfortunately. But anyway, it was a lot of fun. But the Glass Menagerie, I was going to tell you that way. He had come. That was a special play we did because it was for the hearing impaired. It was a record for the blind. Not hearing impaired, I mean records for the blind. And after we staged it, some people came back and they saw Mr. Disney there and said, oh, Mr. Disney, what do you think of the play? And he said, well, Walt said, I think our kids did a good job with it. Said, of course, if we were doing the film version, that young fellow would have to take care of his mother, and the gentleman caller would have to marry the girl. Well, that's a little different ending for Tennessee Williams, but
yeah.
This is Ken, Lynn's co-host here. Did you go into this knowing you wanted to get into acting? I mean, when you went to get a mailroom job? Yeah, I mean, that's people think that's like fiction, that mailroom people. But of course, Jeffrey Katzenberg was said to have started out as a messenger and stuff like that. But so you went there with dreams of doing this sort of thing.
Oh yeah, it was not anything that they encouraged. However, now if you wanted to get into production. In fact, they tried for years to talk me out of the acting foolishness and get into production, And I just didn't want to do it. I wasn't interested in it. So I kept telling them, gee, thanks a lot, but I'm really going to trying to stick with the acting thing. And it didn't really get going until I got into voiceovers. I had a few roles in Disney films, and my first role was on Combat, one shot, 1 week job, but it got me my SAG card.
The television series?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes, yes. I remember seeing syndication of that.
Yeah, so. Right. But anyway, you know, I did my little bit parts here and there. And then when I got into voiceovers, it really started to pay off. I guess it was the first time I've had a really good agent also for voiceovers. I mean, the other on-camera agents had not been doing a whole lot.
Well, do you remember the first thing you did for WED or you know, the parks?
The first thing I did for WED was, I think, the narration for the Rocket to Mars.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I keep forgetting his name. He's.
Did you do Mr. Johnson?
No, it was the
Oh,
ride.
The narrator on the ride, yes.
Yes,
okay.
Right.
All right. Yes, that would okay. That because I'm placing the voice because I remember, you know, I rode that thing a lot. I convinced.
Yeah, that was strictly just my voice. There was nothing added to it. I wasn't doing anything.
Yeah,
to be different because he was just a lieutenant or something like that.
Yeah, I convinced my younger sister that we were actually going, you know, traveling through space. That was a lot of fun.
I imagine a lot of kids thought that, you know.
It was great to think that. But
who knows what they could do with it now with virtual reality rides and all that. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, yeah. That's true. Yeah, I was looking at everything that you've done on Wikipedia, and it's just amazing how many different, you know, you did voiceovers, acting, you know, for video games and cartoon, you know, animated. On our show, we mainly talk about Disneyland, the park, but so I kind of wanted to talk a little bit about some of the stuff you provided for that. And I was looking here, Adventure Through Inner Space.
Yeah, that was just, again, a bunch of the Disney players were brought over to the soundstage. We probably didn't even get paid for that. It was it was just background voices as the people are waiting in line, you know,
Oh, okay.
To get on the ride. And then when you get on the ride, of course, it was good old Paul Frees.
Oh, yeah.
See, that's to me, that it just seems kind of weird because those performances were probably heard more times than anything you did for television or movies. I mean, because there's so many thousands of people constantly going through those attractions.
Oh, yeah.
You know? And it's just like, you know, especially once the park was, you know, now the attendance gets up, you know, it's open every day of the year, and the attendance now gets north of 15 million, you know, 16, 17 million. And if you've done voices for the park, you have millions and millions of people every year hearing it. And it's like, you know, it's not even like they have to go get a DVD somewhere. It's just like,
yeah.
You know, and then, of course, you know, especially the earlier years, it's like you're not getting paid anything to do it. You know?
No, well, we didn't get paid much. We'd get a day rate for whatever it was we were doing. Country Bear, you know, had to work about, the first show was maybe a week it took to record it, all of the songs and everything else. And then the others that followed didn't take that long.
And for Country Bear, you did, explain to the audience, you did Henry?
Henry, yeah, Henry the MC Bear. And yeah. Also did, the first show I did, Max the Stag on the Wall.
Oh, but, gosh, yes.
Yeah.
And the others were not me doing Max, the others were somebody else doing Max.
I did
Henry for all three shows.
I really like those, I really like that. You know, the multiple shows. I really like that theater and the characters and everything. I thought Mark Davis did a good job creating those characters. And of course, you needed the voices. And that was something. That was a good show where you could just sit down and relax. You know, especially for a kid. I was a kid who didn't really like the thrill rides yet. You know, when I was that young. And as I got older, I still appreciated the show, and I thought, this is a really good show, and I was sad to see it close down at Disneyland.
Yeah, I guess when you think about it, I think about it now and then, that the show's been running for, what, 40, 5 years at, in Florida. So it's probably been seen by more people than any Broadway show. It's never anything's run that long, I don't believe.
Yeah, especially if they run it like every 20 minutes or, it's like, it's being seen by so many people. And our listeners who might not be familiar with it, I mean, it's still running at the Magic Kingdom at Walt Disney World. So if on your visits down there, folks, you got to check it out.
Are they running the original show or is it the Vacation Hotel?
They're running the original show, but I understand it's been trimmed down a little bit.
Okay.
Like a few minutes shorter.
Oh my gosh. People's attention spans are so short now.
I know.
I mean, I know they trimmed down, they took a song out of Tiki Room at Disneyland. They changed the Tiki Room show entirely in Florida, but here in Anaheim, they took a song out of that years ago, and just to shorten it a bit.
Mm-hmm. I did the opening, as you go through the Winnie the Pooh ride, which is where Bear Country used to be. I mean, where the Country Bear used to be. It's just the first, as you go into the ride, you hear a kind of a Sebastian Cabot voice narrating, and that's the one I did. But at first, we had narrated all through the ride. There was a lot of narration all through the ride. And then they decided, it's taking too long to get them in and out. Got to get them out, got to get them in and get them out. So they cut all of the narration except that very small piece right at the beginning.
Well, that's kind of funny that, someplace you'd been the MC beforehand, and now you're kind of the voice introducing what's going on. That's pretty funny that it's the same location. And
I know. Yeah.
You were there for both attractions.
Right.
So, I see that you also did you were Captain Nemo for the submarine
ride? For the submarine ride, yes.
Yeah. Was that only in Florida, or was that the one in Anaheim also?
When it was the Nautilus, wherever the Nautilus was, Nautilus was brought out here for a while, right?
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah, and I did it both places, but then they went back to, they've gone to... whatever the other little.
They closed the one in Florida, and then.
Oh, they did, huh?
Then the one here, they saved it, and it.
Finding Nemo.
Finding Nemo. There was a struggle to keep that physical structure there, and they figured, the way we can do it is bring it back is Finding Nemo. So that's what they did. There were three different Country Bear shows. Did you do Henry for all of them?
Oh yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. The other two were the musical director was different from the first. Mm-hmm. The first one was more of the country singers. We had the actual, like the Weavers and people like that come in to record, but the others were George Wilkins was the musical director and. He was a little more modern music oriented, more than country, but he could do country, of course. But it was a little different because we were doing a Christmas show for one thing.
Yes.
So that was primarily Christmas music, and but it was fun to do all three of them. It's fun to work with Thurl Ravenscroft.
Oh, yeah.
That's such a great voice.
Oh yeah. Wow.
And Frank Welker did. Did the raccoon on my hat,
I still remember that. Oh my gosh. Well, the wall trophies, Max, Buff, and Melvin used to freak me out. I mean, I was a little afraid to walk underneath them, because they just seemed so lifelike, and I just thought they were going to start talking to me at any second,
Somebody said they're still in the Winnie the Pooh ride somewhere.
They are. They were hidden in there as, a joke, a tribute thing where, The Imagineers like to do that a lot, where they take something from another attraction and it's a tribute.
Right.
So Wish I could have just kept it there in the first place.
I know, right. Yeah, they keep talking about maybe putting the Country Bears in California Adventure.
Yeah.
Tie in with the bear theme there, but I don't think they'll ever do it,
but it would be nice to do it. I mean, California's got, if you just think about all the different songs that California's been mentioned in, you could do a show just based on that, you know.
That's true. Yeah.
Yeah. But,
did you ever go and see the show and sit in the audience? And
oh yes.
Yeah.
a number of times. Every time I had relatives visiting, of course we had to stop in at Country Bear.
Oh my gosh, so. that has to be trippy, you know. Being there with and of course, you know, it's just voice acting and nobody else there knows it's you.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. I remember one time going on the Mark Twain and I happened to be wearing a jacket, a Disney Studios jacket, and the attendant said, I said, "Oh, you work at the studio?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Why don't you go up to the captain's thing up there? You can see better from way up there." So I went up and right there is a speaker. I had never even paid any attention to the soundtrack that was going, but I was standing with my head right next to the speaker, and the Mark Twain narration comes on, him telling the stories, you know. And I thought, huh, that sounds familiar. Oh, yeah, that's me. I did that years ago.
Oh, my gosh.
Wow. I'm doing the Columbia River ride now is a new one. Well, it's redone one that I've done the voice of the captain on that now.
Oh, nice.
Wow, all over the park. I mean, you know, just from one end of the park to the other.
Yeah, I had my friend's little, I guess she was about 4 or 5 at the time. They were standing by the, you know, the rockets right at the entrance of Tomorrowland. And I do the instructions, you know, buckle your seatbelt and all that stuff for that one.
Oh.
And she was just a baby, and she looked up and she said, "That's Uncle Pete." I couldn't figure out how in the world she would remember that.
I think they added that. I don't even think it opened with that, but I think they added it because I remember the ride operators used to do it live, and then it's like, oh, now they've got a recording.
Mm-hmm.
And so that recording's you then.
You're right. At least it was the last time I went.
No, I'm pretty sure it still is, you know, but wow.
So you did a few things for the Haunted Mansion. I know that you were on the record. Was that
The LP. That's the thing I did.
With Ron Howard on there?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
That's great.
And Thurl Ravenscroft, of course.
Right.
And Roby Lester, I guess, did the girl's voice.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that was fun. That didn't take much time at all, though. It was one of those things where I was at the studio and they said, go on over to Tutti Camerata's studio in Hollywood. We got something we want you to record. I didn't even know what it was, you know.
Yeah.
And I had not heard Paul's. I don't even know if the ride wasn't open yet. I know the ride wasn't open. And so I went there and Tutti handed me the copy and we read it off. At first, when I heard it played back, I thought, well, sounds like a lot of reverb. Maybe a little too much reverb. But kids seem to like it, so.
So they did that even before the attraction opened, huh?
I think so, because I certainly hadn't heard Paul's version. Now, maybe the attraction was open, and I just hadn't gone there yet. But I know that a lot of the young kids that are fans of the record, they were not living in California, and they got the record, you know. And as far as they were concerned, that's what it was supposed to sound like. They didn't know anything about another version.
It's their way of taking a visit, even though they're not seeing it in person. I mean, you know, our listeners have to remember this is before websites and everything where people, you know, can go on and take a look at everybody's pictures from today, you know, right there at the attraction. You know, and back in those days, this was like something that it was kind of a virtual visit.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, there's a website now that has offered all of the music everywhere in the park or Walt Disney World that's ever been played. I mean, they have the music that was played at the animal shelter. Wherever you go, there's music played at Disneyland, you know. There's shops, all of the rides, of course. The bands that played, it's amazing. I don't know where he's getting these tracks, but they're terrific.
Oh, yeah, I think I know what you're talking about. It's Chris, our friend yes. Chris, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Yeah, it's really neat. So you also did, other than Disney, you also did some voiceovers for other productions.
Oh, yeah, I did a lot of cartoons for Hanna-Barbera or for Fred Wolf. Well, we did all of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, the original series.
Wow.
And I played Splinter on that. And Vern, who's the newsman that was kind of a pain in the neck. But Splinter was the one that I did the most.
Yeah.
And we did 192 episodes of that.
Wow.
Wow.
Jeez. That's... Even today, I think, you know, I notice my kids watching shows, and it seems to me that a lot of the shows use the same voice actors, you know?
A lot of them do, yeah. Of course, in the old Hanna-Barbera days, way back in the 60s, and even before, they used Dawes Butler and three or four others, and that was about it. I mean, you always saw the same name. June Foray, of course, but she was wonderful. And last I heard, she's still working, and she's in her 90s.
She had she did a voice inside of Pirates of the Caribbean, I know.
Yeah,
she's telling, she's talking to them, they're dunking the mayor in Pirates,
uh-huh.
And she's up in the window saying, you know, don't be chicken, you know, don't be chicken, you know, and I remember that because she actually came to my school one time and talked. There was a teacher at the school, I don't know what she was doing teaching at the school, but she had these connections, and she would bring these people in to talk, and I'm thinking, what is she doing here teaching? Because she wasn't the best teacher, but she'd teach the kids filmmaking, you know. Uh-huh. Like she would teach fourth graders filmmaking and everything. But anyway, so you got to do Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, of all things.
Yeah.
And I mean, there's probably people who've heard your voice a million times and don't even make the connection. You know, it's just, it's one of those things where you can do people don't recognize you, do they, when you go someplace?
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Now, the other one that I did, we did 65 episodes of Defenders of the Earth. I played Mandrake the Magician on that. That was a lot of fun. We had some good people.
Wow. See, this is to me, it's like, you know, this is great because you can do all this stuff and then people hear your work all the time, but you don't get hounded when you go someplace, you know?
Not at all.
But you did. Oh, I was going to say, you did do some things where you were actually acting, you know, on film.
Oh, yeah. But they were usually small roles.
They were,
I guess the one that people remember the most was my tiny role in The Love Bug as the cop on a bridge.
Oh, okay.
Herbie's trying to commit suicide, you know.
Oh, man. Well.
Wow. So you're still working?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, just went over to do a thing for Universal the other day. Keep at it, you know.
Oh, wow. That's a lot of work. I mean, just a large body of work over the years.
Oh, yeah. Well, if you're around as long as I've been around. I've been around here since 1959. Actually, I got here in 57, but I was only here 4 months and I got drafted. Oh. So I went into service for 2 years and came right back.
Man. Now, where were you from originally?
Louisiana. Oh. A little town called New Iberia, Louisiana, which used to be on the Tabasco labels, but they decided to get more specific when they got their own zip code. And for the past 20 years or so, it said Avery Island now. New Iberia, which is the setting for, I don't know if you've ever read any of James Lee Burke's books, but he's set it right in our little old hometown where he grew up, too.
Wow.
And he's had several of his books made into movies.
And you decided you were just going to come to the West Coast and...
Yeah, well, it was either here or New York, and
true.
I never liked cold weather.
Oh, wow. That's crazy.
So do you visit the park often?
No, not very often. No. Only when I have small children visiting or mm-hmm. a family that wants to take little kids that I know, you know.
Yeah.
Then I'll go to the park again. But the crowds are just really.
It's gotten a lot more crowded. More of the year now. Which I guess is you know the result of marketing and putting in new attractions and stuff. But it's just like, wow. I wish it wasn't. I miss the old days.
Yeah. Well, I'm amazed that you know people can afford to pay those prices now too.
That's the other thing. I rant about those all the time on. On the podcast here.
Well, when you do go to the park, is there any attraction that you know, one of your favorites that you like to go on?
Well, I've always liked the Haunted Mansion, of course.
Yeah.
And I always liked the old Jungle River ride because it's one of the first ones I ever got on.
Oh, yeah.
It may not be around, and of course, I understand they're going to redo all of the Thunder Mountain area.
Yeah, the Rivers of America, you know, the kind of behind Thunder Mountain there, the Big Thunder Ranch and everything, that's definitely going away. We were just talking about that in our current events part of the podcast. They're going to, you know, install Star Wars Land back there, which doesn't make sense to me, but...
Not the location, no. You know, why not Tomorrowland somewhere?
I don't know. That's a good question. So they're going to alter things a little bit back there from what we understand. Just how much remains to be seen, you know? Yeah. So who knows? They might change the narration on the Columbia again. I mean, we'll see.
That's possible, yeah. That was changed not too long ago. I remember the old train ride long before Thunder Mountain, when it was just a train ride through Rainbow Caverns and all of that stuff.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Had the little shop, the little town that you went past, you know.
Yeah, Rainbow Ridge.
Yeah. And there was a barbershop. And inside was a cutout, really. It was just a two-dimensional cutout of the barber waiting in the chair for a customer, reading a newspaper, sitting in his chair. And that was a picture of me that we had taken at the studio. And they did a big blow-up, and they cut it out and stuck it over there. So for a long time, I appeared in person, sort of.
That's neat.
That's a fondly remembered attraction that people wish, you know, they could get back. The Mine Train Through Nature's Wonderland, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And of the newer ones, I mean, I like a lot of them. Of course, I always loved the Matterhorn, but the trouble is too long a wait to get on it now. I just can't take that wait anymore.
Yes.
Star Tours is fun.
Yeah.
For the virtual reality things, I think that's great.
Oh, yeah.
I consider Star Tours kind of the update to the Rocket to Mars thing.
Exactly. Yeah.
It's just a fictionalized update.
Exactly.
You know, put you in a room and shake you around and, you know, yeah.
Yeah, all you did on the Rocket to Mars is your seat kind of dropped out from under you a little bit.
Yeah.
And there was a vibration, I guess. Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you have to do any work for California Adventure?
Let's see. Have I done anything for California Adventure? I don't think so.
Yeah.
I can't think of much that has any kind of narration over there or anything, you know.
Yeah.
No, I've never done anything for California Adventure.
Huh. All right.
Probably why it wasn't as well received as Disneyland. Yeah. it's missing Pete. You know. Yeah.
Well, if they ever do what they've been talking about, putting Country Bears over there, but I kind of doubt that's going to happen. I mean, you know, the Winnie the Pooh thing all came about because they they had the Winnie the Pooh characters walking around Country Bear, and they realized that the kids were only attracted to Winnie, not so much to Country Bear. So on that note, they decided, oh, well, let's put Winnie back here. And I always thought, well, that's fine, but Winnie doesn't really belong. Winnie's not a bear. He's a stuffed toy, and he belongs in Fantasyland, you know.
Yeah.
But well, having been from you're preaching to the choir here. I mean, since you being from Louisiana, you can probably, you know, it's like, look, Critter Country is supposed to be kind of a backwoods extension of New Orleans, you know. It's supposed to be, you know, the Old South and you know.
Yeah, and even the Haunted Mansion, it's a continuation of the Old South, going past New Orleans Square.
I wish they could have put the Pooh stuff over in Fantasyland, but you know they didn't, and now it's kind of hard for people to get to. So, but with Star Wars, if the rumors we hear about Star Wars are true, one of the entrances will be back over there. So who knows? Winnie the Pooh might get more life, you know, more foot traffic back there. But we'll see.
Possibly. Well, that's what they complained about the Country Bear, that they weren't getting enough traffic back there. Well, because there's no way out. You have to double out the same way.
If the crowd flow is just not the same. But, so, Lynn, did you have any more?
No, I think that was great. Yeah.
We've interrogated him enough?
Yeah.
Well, it was fun talking to you fellows.
Yes, thank you very much, Pete. Really appreciate it.
Well, I especially appreciate your work, Pete. Me and my coworkers, we would always we'd do different voices just to pass the time while we were working at the park. So I can really appreciate the work of a professional.
Well, thank you very much.
Great. Well,
appreciate the recognition. Why? You don't necessarily get a whole lot of recognition as a voiceover person.
Well, we appreciate you.
Yeah, we do. I appreciate it.
And thanks for letting our listeners know all the different things you've done. You know, they'll, I'm sure, have their ears open next time they get to the park, and they'll be able to say, hey, wait a minute, that's the guy we heard on the podcast.
Yeah.
Okay, well, good luck with the other podcasts.
Great. Well, thanks a lot, Pete.
You're welcome.
Okay, well, that concludes episode 171 of the Sweep Spot Podcast. We want to thank Pete Renaday for coming on our show.
Yeah, what a nice guy.
Yeah, really nice guy. I learned a lot from that interview. I thought I did all my homework and knew everything he did, but he surprised me. And I'm sure that he did many more things that we didn't even talk about, so...
So listen for him when you get to the park next.
That's right. A lot of fun. He was our second voice actor we've had on our show. It's kind of fun to talk to them because, like you were saying, they're not really noticed in public or, you know, when they go to the parks, but they are just as important as anyone else that's you know, done anything at the parks. So really cool. So also wanted to mention we'd really love a review on iTunes if you haven't done so already and you've been a listener of the show for a while. We'd really appreciate that. That could be a Christmas present to us from you.
Aww.
And if you're looking for Christmas gifts, you can also get our book, Cleaning the Kingdom.
Yay, it makes a great gift.
Yep, over at our website.
If somebody's interested in Disney or theme parks or Disneyland in particular, or if anyone has ever worked with a broom or a mop, they will like Cleaning the Kingdom.
They will. It's getting raving reviews. So
it's getting rave reviews and raving reviews.
Raving and rave.
Yes.
So we appreciate everything you know, just listening to the show and the people. I get emails all the time from listeners saying how much they either like it or I get, you know, just random emails with information. You know, we'll talk about the Haunted Mansion and someone will send me an article they found about the Haunted Mansion in 1972 or something. And it's really neat. So thanks, guys, for all that you do, and really do appreciate it. So hope you enjoyed the interview with Pete. And we hope to have more like that in our next year, 2016. We still have another show left to go, and then we'll take a little break, and we'll be back in 2016. So thanks again for listening, and we'll talk with you next time.
Good night, folks.